Hey PC World fans, Adam here, and I bought an eGPU in 2020. It might have been a bad decision. So let me start from the beginning. Recently, I moved from a fairly large loft kind of space to a smaller one-bedroom apartment. And rather than try to cram a large desk and my full-size tower inside this smaller apartment, I said, you know what? I am lucky enough to work here at PC World and have a whole host of PC options available to me. So you know what, why don't I discard my full-size tower for a little bit and see if there are other options that I would be comfortable to game and work on daily. So when I was looking at it, I was focusing on three main options that I could move to. The first one was a full-size gaming laptop, you know, something that had a desktop class GPU in it, a nice big beefy cooling system, and something that could really push a lot of frames both in gaming and render times in the video production that I do. So that was one option. The next option was to build a small form factor machine. I would have to still have a monitor and a mouse and keyboard setup, or I could plug it into my TV. There's other options on how to do those things. But the third one, and the one that I was kind of most intrigued about, was an eGPU. Now, I've heard over the years plenty of horror stories of eGPUs, and I know that I haven't encountered anybody who's like a really hardcore eGPU enthusiast, but they're still on the market, and I still think that the idea of an eGPU being able to attach a desktop class graphics card to a laptop, there's something intriguing and magical about that. So I said, you know what? First up, I'm gonna try an eGPU in my daily life for a while and see if that works. With the fallback to say, hey, you know what, I can still look into those other options, but the investment that I need to make into an eGPU isn't too much right off the bat. So once I settled on that, I wanted to kind of put together a little list of things that I was looking for, and it wasn't too much. I really wanted to focus on size. Once again, I'm in a small place. I'm pairing it with a laptop, so the idea of a really small footprint is kind of appealing to me. I also wanted to focus on one where you could swap out the graphics cards. We have a library of graphics cards here that I can test with and choose from and kind of see what would work best for my workflow. And I'm lucky in that situation, so you know, I know that's not something that everyone has access to, but I did want to take advantage of that. And also I wanted to focus on something that looked good. I do appreciate a really nice made piece of electronics, so I didn't want to get something that was a little too chintzy or, you know, didn't really fit with the aesthetic I was going for. So with that in mind, I wanted to go out and see what options I had, and I definitely looked at a lot of videos and reviews, but one of the websites that helped a lot was eGPU.io. They have charts, you know, showing all the different EPGU options, the price, the technical aspects of it, and I really enjoyed using that site. It was a good site, so you should check it out. But the main one I wanted to really look at that I had heard about for many years was the Razer Core V2. It kind of ticked off a lot of those boxes in terms of size and the affordability and the options for, you know, swapping out different graphics cards. Unfortunately, and I didn't realize this until I was looking, it's not available anymore. I mean, you still can buy some third hand, but the price is a little inflated, and I don't think it was a viable option. So then I was looking at Razer's follow-up to that, which is the Razer Core X. Now, I will say that most places that I was looking at for eGPU resources kind of claimed that the Razer Core X was the best option for most people who are looking for an eGPU. So I kind of started there and said, okay, well, if this is the one I have to get, then that's cool. I like the Razer aesthetic. It's really well made, and the price isn't too bad at $300 for the non-Chroma one, which is I would be fine with. So before I pulled the trigger on the Core X, I was looking around at other options, and while I did find some interesting ones out there, I did come across one that I was like, wow, okay, this isn't too bad. I've never heard of that. And that was the ASUS XG Station Pro. Clocks in at $330. It was very small, still had a really nice aesthetic to it. So That's the one I chose, and that's what's sitting right here in front of me today. So a couple things about the ASUS XG Station Pro. It is really nicely built. It's got some chamfered edges. It comes in this nice gray color. It has perforations on both of the side panels to be able to allow plenty of cooling. And the way that you tear it down actually is really easy to be able to swap cards in and out. But more importantly, I really enjoyed the size. Out of a lot of the ones out there, this was one of the smaller options that allowed you to swap GPUs. And that kind of was probably the main reason why I went with this over the Razer Core X. So it's $330. It supports GPUs up to a little over 12 inches, which is most of the ones out there. And like I said, it's really small. And the way they did that was that they didn't include a PSU inside the system. They actually went with an external power brick, which when I first thought about it, I actually kind of like that. That was fine, because if I'm going to plug this down on the ground and put it down there, I would rather have this bulkiness down on the ground than up on the desk by me. So even though this is a beast, I was okay with that. That's actually a nice trade-off. But just beware that because of it being an external brick, it actually only supports up to 300 watts for the GPUs, which kind of excludes some really power-hungry GPUs out there. But for the most part, and the ones I was going to be using, it was fine. While it doesn't have a ton of ports, it does at least have one USB-C pass-through port, which you could use for a storage device or whatever. I haven't really had to do that yet, because that's not really what I need in my workflow, but at least it's there and handy if I do need it. Also, it came with something that, at least according to my research, was kind of a little bit of a bonus. The Thunderbolt 3 cable that came with it is 1.5 meters long, which supposedly is three times the length of most of the cables that come with eGPUs, so that was kind of a nice plus. And what good is any piece of PC hardware unless it has RGB? And yes, this does have RGB. It has one strip along the side that lights up and kind of glows the graphics card on the inside. So, you know what? There we go. Cool. I did it. I got RGB. Now, this isn't a review of the XG Station Pro, but I will be following up a later date with benchmarks and my final thoughts on using it for a longer period of time. But I did want to include some of my initial thoughts of working with this. The first laptop I used it with was a Lenovo ThinkPad P1 with a Quadro card in it, and I had a lot of problems. I will go into it in a deeper detail in a later date, but then I asked Gordon, who I work with, to let me borrow this Dell XPS, which had a 1660 Ti in it, and things have been a lot smoother since I've been using that. Now, I will say I have done most of my gaming on the internal display of the laptop, and yes, I can confirm you're definitely giving up some performance by using the internal display because of the way that Thunderbolt works and has to have the overhead on the CPU to be able to come back and display it on the screen. I have plugged it into an external display a couple times, and it worked fine. You can watch some of these gaming streams that we've done with that setup. But for the most part, that's not the way I'm going to be using it. I might hook it up to my TV if I get the opportunity, but for the most part, the idea was to use it with the laptop screen, and to have that kind of performance loss because of it was a bummer. I felt it, and I wasn't super happy about that. I've also run into a couple games that just have a hard time. They keep hitching, especially if I'm running like a benchmark, and you can just see these crazy frame spikes. I'm not quite sure what it is. It's a little bit out of the depth of my understanding, but I think what it has to do is with the Thunderbolt 3 protocol. And so some of these hitches in only some games, it's a tough pill to swallow, because the idea with my tower was that I can play any game on it and have it run well, relatively fine. But with the eGPU setup, if I have to worry about specific games not really being that compatible with it, that would be a bummer, especially if it's a game that I really love. But when it does work, it does feel pretty magical to have a laptop running high frame rates and being able to use a desktop GPU. I like that idea of having a portable laptop that I can kind of go around and do work, but then when I go home, I plug it in and I get more power. It feels cool. It feels unique and feels like something I've never really experienced before. At this point in time, I can't come out and say definitively if you should buy this eGPU or any eGPU in general. But like I said, when it does work, it feels magical and it feels like a piece of unique PC hardware that I've personally never experienced. And I'm excited to try it out further. So be sure to subscribe to see further testing of this eGPU and other PC hardware here on PC World.